Good afternoon. I'm so pleased to welcome you all to the launch of the first report from the American Academy's Challenges for International Scientific Partnerships Initiative, America and the International Future of Science. Our Challenge for International Scientific Partnerships project was commissioned to articulate the scientific, cultural, economic, and political benefits of international collaboration, and to propose policy changes and best practices that could make the U.S. a better partner in international scientific relationships, particularly as we grapple with unprecedented global challenges. The project has two major areas of focus: large-scale science and emerging science partners. This work is made possible thanks to the generous support of the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation, the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, and the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation. Today, our program will focus on the first of the project's three reports, which explores the importance of international collaborations to the United States and contains a set of recommendations for collaborations with nations with which we have strained diplomatic relations, including China. I'm grateful to those of you joining who participated in project roundtables over the past few years. These meetings inspired several of the report's case studies of successful international collaborations. The project will soon release two additional reports: Bold Ambition, International Large-Scale Science, an exploration of how the United States can enhance its role in international mega science partnerships, and Global Connections, Emerging Science Partners, a look at U.S. scientific collaborations with countries seeking to boost their specific capacity and mechanisms for how the U.S. can more effectively and equitably build those partnerships. Many of you joined us for this webinar, participated in workshops and listening sessions for these forthcoming reports. I would like to express our sincere gratitude for your time and contributions. We look forward to sharing these reports upon their release in the new year, and we hope that you will see your perspectives reflected in those findings. I'm pleased to be joined today by the leaders of this initiative who have worked tirelessly to guide this project. The American Academy is so grateful for their efforts. I will introduce them briefly, but full biographies can be found on our website. Artie Bienenstock is Professor Emeritus of Photon Science, Special Assistant to the Stanford University President for Federal Research Policy, and Director of the Wallenberg Research Link. He has worked tirelessly to ensure that the U.S. has a science and technology workforce at all levels that can meet the nation's needs, and was appointed by President Obama to the National Science Board of the National Science Foundation. Artie was elected to the American Academy in 2013, and is co-lead of the overall initiative, as well as co-chair of the project's large-scale science working group. Peter Michelson is the Luke Blossom Professor of Physics at Stanford University with a focus on astrophysics. He leads the international team that built and now operates the Large Area Telescope on the Fermi Gamma Ray Space Telescope, and is a past member of the NASA Office of Space Science Structure and Evolution. Peter was elected to the Academy in 2013, as a co-lead of the initiative and co-chair of the Large-Scale Science Working Group alongside Artie. Shirley Malcolm is Senior Advisor and Director of Education and Human Resources Program at the American Association for the Advancement of Science. Her career has focused on improving accessibility of education and careers in science and engineering for underrepresented groups. She was appointed by President Clinton to the National Science Board of the National Science Foundation, as well as to the President's Committee of Advisors on Science and Technology. Shirley has been a member of this academy since 1995 and is co-chair of the Emerging Science Partners Working Group. Olufunmilayo Olopade is a physician and the Walter L. Palmer Distinguished Service Professor of Medicine and Human Genetics, Dean for Global Health, and Director of the Center for Clinical Cancer Genetics at the University of Chicago. She is a pioneer in the field of breast cancer research. Funmi has been a member of the American Academy since 2010 and co-chairs the Emerging Science Partner Working Group alongside Shirley for this project. Challenges for International Scientific Partnerships launched in 2018, but the events of this year have only underscored the importance of this work. In May, the project leaders released an urgent call for continued and additional collaboration between the U.S. and international scientific partners in the fight against coronavirus. As the statement said, "The pandemic is a crisis and it will be felt by all, regardless of social, economic, or political background. Addressing COVID-19 will be a major fight of our lifetimes, and we should come together as a global community to mitigate the threat this virus poses to society. We must learn from the experiences and knowledge of our international scientific colleagues as the U.S. remains fully engaged as a leading member of the community. For those of you who are joining us today who are international scientists, we hope that this report will hold interest for you as we work to encourage bridge building between U.S. and international scientists and science policymakers. If the U.S. is to expand its international collaborations, we will need to work hand in hand with our international partners. We will begin the program with an overview of key takeaways of the report from Peter and a deeper dive into the special section of the report focused on U.S.-China relations from Artie, followed by a discussion on how the COVID-19 pandemic has created new opportunities for future international collaboration between Shirley and Funmi. After these presentations, Funmi will lead all panelists in a moderated conversation, and we welcome your questions at that time. Please use the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen to submit questions for the panel throughout the program. The chat box is also open for sharing impressions with fellow audience members. And now, it is my pleasure to turn things over to Peter Michelson. Peter?
Thank you, David. So as David said, this study was carried out by an incredible group of scientists and policymakers that formed the project steering committee and two working groups with members, as we say, from a variety of scientific and policy areas. One of the working groups focused on large-scale science partnerships and the other on emerging science partnerships, primarily in the global south. And I have to say that the study was only possible because of the leadership of Academy President David Oxtoby and his predecessor Jonathan Fanton, and the guidance of the Academy's governing bodies, along with superb support and research by the Academy staff, particularly Amanda Vernon and Rebecca Tiernan, and many consultations with US and international agencies and scientific leadership around the world. So thanks to all of them. Let me start then with the observation that while many US policies and practices related to international scientific cooperation originated in the decades following World War II, when US R&D spending eclipsed that of all other nations, that spending now constitutes only about 1/4 of global R&D expenditures. As global investments in science have increased, international collaboration has risen as well. During the past 25 years, the percent of US scientific publications co-authored with scientists from international institutions has increased from about 17% to nearly 40%. Furthermore, international collaboration often strengthens the impact of scientific research. As one marker of this, US science publications involving international collaborators rank considerably higher than all other US science publications in field-weighted citation impact analyses, and in some cases, nearly doubling the average citation impact of publications with only collaborators from the same country. So while participation in international scientific partnerships come with challenges that must be addressed, it is an important conclusion of this study that the benefits to the United States of international scientific partnerships and the opportunities to provide a leadership role in them are important and in most cases far outweigh the challenges. The report released today discusses 6 imperatives for the United States, not only to continue, but also to strengthen participation in international scientific collaboration. And these are, you can see them listed here. They include addressing global challenges, sustaining a strong STEM workforce, boosting US economic competitiveness, protecting US national security, addressing funding challenges, particularly for large-scale projects, and building ethical norms and scientific guidelines. I'll briefly touch on just a few aspects of these imperatives. Both fundamental scientific questions and science related to global challenges are not defined by national boundaries, and progress often requires data and expertise from more than one country. I'll mention one recent example from my own field of astrophysics of an international science investigation that addressed a fundamental science question. On August 17th, 2017, LIGO reported detection of gravitational radiation from a coalescing pair of neutron stars and combined with detection of a very short burst of gamma rays by the Fermi Gamma Ray Space Telescope, localized the source in a distant galaxy. The rapid reporting triggered observations by more than 70 telescopes around the world, including of optical radiation produced by the merger event that showed for the first time that these merger events are important producers of the heavy elements of the universe, including gold. Achievements such as these capture the imagination of people around the globe and are examples of what humanity can accomplish through imagination, cooperation, and long-term investment. These investigations also often require pushing beyond the limits of existing technology, a push that in turn can yield major advances and applications important for society more broadly. Synchrotron X-ray sources, made possible by the development of high-energy particle accelerators, are an example. Today, there are more than 50 such facilities around the world that, among other things, enable the measurement of biomolecular structures in three dimensions, such as that of the SARS-CoV-19 virus. That brings me to global challenges such as pandemics and climate change that absolutely require broad and sustained international collaboration to address. These must also be treated as national security threats to the United States. But they are also threats that are faced by every nation and require international cooperation among all nations, including with emerging science partners. The crisis we're now in clearly demonstrates this. The United States must be engaged in international science partnerships. As other countries promote increasingly large international projects, the United States runs the risk that future U.S. scientists may be excluded from some of the world's leading scientific projects and associated technological advances unless the United States contributes to these advances and is prepared strategically to commit to collaboration on the funding, the planning, the development, and operation of new scientific partnerships that may involve large facilities and capabilities both at home and abroad. Finally, while the benefits of international scientific collaboration for the United States and the world are substantial and important and growing and eclipse the risks they can present, those risks, particularly to U.S. national security, must be carefully managed while recognizing there are also benefits from scientific collaboration with potential adversaries and countries with which the United States has strained relations. My co-chair, Artie Bienenstock, will speak to these concerns in greater detail. Thank you.
The report includes a special section on the U.S.-China research relationships. There are 4 points in that section of the report that should be stressed. One, China is by far the primary nation with which U.S. researchers collaborate. Interviews with U.S. scientists participating in such collaborations indicate that their Chinese counterparts often have unique capabilities that make forefront research possible. One example is in advanced materials synthesis and refinement. It is also essential that we collaborate in areas of common concern like climate change and pandemics, the major threats to the national security of both nations. Two, It is vital that the nation maintain a strong science and technology workforce, and graduate students from China are an important part of that. They earn about one quarter of the advanced degrees awarded in computer science, engineering, mathematics, and the physical sciences. These are the fields that are so important in the designated industries of the future. Over 80% stay, contributing to our nation's economy, health, and national security. The remainder return to China, contributing to its well-being. Many of those continue to collaborate with us. We must keep the students coming. We must never forget that students are the most important product of our nation's universities. Three, an essential part of the United States' strength in science and technology is the openness with which ideas flow. Particularly in our research universities, that openness yields better educated students and better research. It helps attract the best and the brightest from around the world. The costs of openness are smaller than the risks of a weakened workforce or declining quality of research. When information or research needs to be secure, National Security Decision Directive 189, promulgated by President Reagan and reconfirmed by Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice, should be followed. It indicates that classification is the appropriate mechanism. If the United States believes that foreign nation individuals should not be participating in university research, the visa vetting process is the appropriate mechanism for that. Nevertheless, point four, nevertheless, we must recognize that inappropriate transferring of ideas and intellectual property to China is serious, even if it is infrequent. It is vital that universities rigorously enforce their conflict of interest and conflict of commitment policies to inhibit such practices. Universities should also have procedures for ensuring ethical behavior of researchers. The U.S. must wisely balance and manage both collaboration and competition with China. It is vital that the government increase its funding for fundamental research and the states increase their support of public higher education if we are to maintain scientific and technological leadership. The steady decline in the fraction of the GDP devoted to federal support of engineering and the physical sciences weakens us while China is increasing its support in those areas. Similarly, the declining per capita funding of public higher education means greater student debt and less ability for them to obtain advanced degrees in these fields and increases our dependence on immigrants. We cannot let these trends continue. Thank you.
That's really very nicely said, Peter and Artie. And while we're waiting for some questions from our audience, I just wanted you to maybe expand on what you had said during some of our convening about why we should be in it together. And that is, how do we deal with pandemics, the next pandemic, how do we deal with climate change? And then of course, the biggest challenge of all, poverty and inequality. So how can US engagement in scientific collaborations actually begin to tackle some of these problems that are global challenges for all of us? Maybe Artie can start and then Peter join right in.
Let's take global science, climate control, climate change as an example. The problem is global. We are all affected by it, but the solutions have to be local. Different people and places face different problems and different ways of combating climate change. It's vital, therefore, that we have strong science around the world in every part of the globe. And collaboration with U.S., by the U.S., and education of scientists from around the world will help them solve their problems locally and help us in the end.
Finally, I could add to what Artie said in terms of pandemics. I think that is an example that, a case study that we're living through. And I think it clearly demonstrates that international science collaboration is required from every part of the planet. And in particularly with scientists in China who first sequenced the virus and the development of a what looks like a very successful vaccine at a lab in Germany, and its production by Pfizer and other companies that are engaged in that. And that those kind of connections are international and they're required. I think what worries me is that many under-resourced countries in the global South, particularly Africa, should not be left out of that. And there is incredible talent on the African continent. It is the youngest population on this planet. And we need to be engaged with the future of that continent and its young scientists. And I think the United States should be stepping up to the plate more than we have and be very engaged in the global South.
Yeah, as you and I have talked about, I think we're talking about making sure that Africa has its first large scale facility, and maybe the US should be leading that effort. I have some questions here, and one has to do with how can we leverage private industry collaborations to further global public cooperation. So which of you wants to tackle the problem of the other stakeholders that need to come to the table?
I think a good example is in the history of synchrotron radiation. That part of it got started at Stanford in the synchrotron lab, and there, Bell Labs and Xerox and other companies contributed to develop the lab in its early stages. And that in turn enhanced the science of all the synchrotron radiation laboratories users. We have a similar opportunity, as you said, with the African synchrotron facility being considered. And again, there is a chance for industry to contribute. But one sees major American companies establishing research labs around the world, including Africa. And that very process enhances their research capabilities as well as the local capabilities.
Absolutely. So Peter, this next question belongs to you. So regarding large facility international collaboration, how do we ensure reciprocity? Could there be a partnership of equals? If I pay for it, do I get to use it more than others? So in other words, how can we ensure that all partners in large facilities openly share data and provide access to their facilities?
I think the answer to that, I think it's very important that partnerships are equal, and there are different measures of that equality, different forms, whether it's financial or providing talent or providing other kinds of resources. And I think all partners have to have a stake in the outcome. And most important, I think they have to have discussions early on and and develop a collaboration that is very solid so that when there's a crisis and there's a problem, they come together and solve the problem. And that to me is the most important thing. And that involves starting with what I would call peer-to-peer collaborations and build on those. And I think it's absolutely essential. And I've experienced that myself with a very large collaboration that started with discussions, scientist to scientist. Then we involved agencies and government sponsors around the world. And when there was a problem, everybody was used to working together and we were all committed to the same goals. And we did what was best to achieve those goals. And I think that's really important.
Yeah, and I have a few questions that are sort of clustered around, should we be thinking regionally? And I know that our convening went to different regions of the world. So what are your thoughts about regional collaborations? And then some questions have to do with, how about Egypt and the Gulf countries? How can they get engaged? And then of course, how can we get more partnership globally with Africa and the rest of the world?
I think with Egypt and the Middle East, we did have a regional sounding in that part of the world. And there's one example of an international laboratory there that I think Artie should actually speak to because he's very familiar with it. And it's in fact a synchrotron facility located in Jordan called Sesame. And maybe Artie could say a bit about that.
Yeah, Artie, yes.
The synchrotron facility in Jordan involves, as I recall, 11 nations. It was led by Khalid Toukan, a fellow, a foreign member of the American Academy, with the strong support of the king. But Israel is a participant, Egypt's a participant, Iran is a participant, and so on. And what you see is that countries that have relatively strained relations chose to cooperate to build a facility for all. A facility like that offers not only opportunities for people from different countries to work together, but also to would provide advanced scientific capabilities in regions where otherwise the facilities are quite limited. So I think it's a remarkable example. There's a similar facility in Campinas in Brazil, and we hope there will soon be one in Africa.
Fantastic. On that note, there's also a question about, so we talked about the large-scale facility. How about the peer-to-peer collaborations? Because I know that the committee actually asked questions about that. How can small universities be part of the action? Not everybody has the resources that Stanford University has. So how can they be part of the action? Peter, maybe you can join and say,
answer that. Well, I think one has to start with, I think the principal product of a university, if I put it that way, are the students that we educate. And I think having educational exchanges with American universities and developing links university to university and developing networks of collaborators in that way is important. I think it's also important that there has to be at least a critical mass of infrastructure in parts of the world that are under-resourced. And I think that is really an important need that has to be carefully addressed. And that requires a financial investment of some kind because you have to have that in order, the talent will come.
That's wonderful. I think on that note, maybe we can get Shirley introduced, but we'll come back to the question of engaging students and making sure that we can get the next generation going.
Actually, that's a lovely segue into our conversation.
Absolutely.
I'm pleased that we were able to introduced the idea of how to address the emerging science partnerships within the largest focus on the challenges of international scientific collaboration. Because a lot of the work that is being done peer-to-peer. And it's being done between a scientist, for example, in the U.S., including in smaller institutions, and their friend or colleague who happens to be in some other country. And I think that the ideas that emerge from our conversations were really quite powerful. That is the need for the countries, no matter at what level of resources that they might have, to be able to engage talent within their region, to be able to use science to support their development goals, looking at the sustainable development goals and how they apply to the individual country, as well as the issue of how to build capacity within those countries. We had a very strong focus on women and the talent that women can bring, as well as a strong focus on early career scientists. Our global young scientists were a breath of fresh air in terms of the ideas that they have and their desire to support these collaborations at every level. So I was very pleased that Artie and Peter got as excited as we were, for me, around the question of the emerging science partners. And I do, in fact, think that there are lots of opportunities to move forward. I think COVID has basically shown us a way forward. When we were prevented from going to one of our meetings because all of a sudden it became impossible to travel, became dangerous to travel, then we pivoted. And I thank the staff, I thank Becca and Amanda for pivoting and bringing us into this more virtual discussion forum. But it allowed us to go all over the world and to see the possibility all over the world.
Yeah, and I think what's actually really interesting, and I want to go back now to some of the questions that have come up from the audience, is about training. The question about the huge knowledge divide in terms of critical mass of scientists and engineers, and how do we ensure win-win in international collaboration, especially when it comes to students who come here. Some of them may stay here, as Archie said, or some may go back to their country. How essential is it for us to actually have a diverse talent pool that we invite to come to the U.S.? And then, of course, how do we ensure that with emerging science partners, we can actually engage in a more diverse research questions?
Well, I think that Artie was talking about the fact that China sends a lot of students come to the U.S. Well, other places send students to the U.S. as well. And they build relationships and they form friendships and they form connections and they form research partnerships as well. And so whether they stay here and then reach back into their countries, into their communities, into the institutions that they may have attended there, or whether they return home and then reach to the U.S. to maintain those collaborations, I think that we all win. I love the phrasing, the idea that Muhammad Hassan talked about, this whole question, issue of brain circulation, that in fact it allows us to maintain these relationships. And it allows us to do borderless, as it were, research as we are able to continue to work and to maintain those peer-to-peer interactions.
Yeah. And let me ask you, what do you feel now that we have really been dealing with racism in biomedical research? enterprise as well as the pandemic. So how should we be thinking about gender, equity, inclusion, and diversity as we move forward post this pandemic?
I think we have to double down on those issues. You know, I think that it presents an opportunity because we have had a reckoning with these inequities. It presents an opportunity to have honest dialogue. We're not the only ones who have problems around issues of race in the U.S. I know that I have encountered colleagues who are in Europe who talk about the treatment of Black Europeans, Europeans who have come from who have emerged from the diasporas of their country. And these are problems everywhere. And I think that by facing them globally, acknowledging them globally, and then having honest dialogue around the value of inclusion as opposed to exclusion, then we can move forward together. And that is what I hope. I do have a lot more, I guess, faith in the young scientists who I think have had a wide engagement with each other and see the possibilities. And I want us to really draw from the energy and the expectations that they have for inclusion to be able to reimagine the scientific enterprise and to reimagine in such a way that science is able to help us solve the real ongoing wicked problems that we have within the world.
Yeah, absolutely. So on this note, maybe we can bring Artie and Peter back, and then I'm going to ask you, Shirley, while they're coming back, what was most surprising to you as we convened in different parts of the world and met scientists from, you know, our first convening in Accra, in Ghana, to Latin America, to the Caribbean, to Asia, Southeast Asia? What moment stood out to you the most?
For me, I'll answer first, but for me, it felt like family. It made the kind of recognition of a global scientific community, that these were people who were cared about the same things that we cared about. They looked at issues of climate change and food security. They may have different priorities based on the needs of their own country or region. But in fact, there was this fundamental belief that science could help provide solutions to the problems that all of us were facing, and that we needed to embrace it and embrace a kind of an inclusive view of working together to solve these problems.
Absolutely. And we have a question here, because in fact, we convened all over the world. And I remember we had a meeting in London where we wanted to engage with our European partners. So I have a question here that we have talked about China and the challenges with China. How about what can the European Union, what can the United Kingdom and South Korea, Japan, all of these countries that also have a very strong science culture, what can they contribute in terms of international science partnerships? And maybe Artie can start to answer that question.
First of all, you know, we have been collaborating with scientists in those countries for years. As I look to the emerging partners, many of the European countries have more experience in dealing with those countries than we do in the United States. And I think it would often be valuable to partner with those European countries as we approach the emerging countries. That is, that we do this cooperatively as allies. I can recall I worked with a French colleague in my field, and she in turn would go regularly to Algeria to work with scientists there. And I think of the benefits if the two of us had gone together, how helpful we could have been.
Yeah, absolutely. Peter, maybe you can talk about your experience at CERN and why what we need to learn to be better partners with our European colleagues.
Yeah, well, actually my experience, I have some limited experience with CERN, but with the Fermi Observatory, which was mentioned earlier, that actually started as a collaboration primarily with European nations, three nations in particular, and with Japan and laboratories in the United States and universities. And so it had about five countries involved, six countries, and it now has more than a dozen. And the reason is the young students that graduated, got degrees in your institutions in Europe and the United States, often would return to their home country. Now we have collaborators in three countries in Asia, and also in Africa. And these are all young scientists. And I think it's really important for old fogies like me to, number one, support them. I'm, okay, well, we're all getting there. But I think it's important to look out for the young talent and encourage it. That is crucial. And senior people in an international collaboration, that's one of their primary responsibilities. And I think that, and I was going to go back to what Shirley said, the virtual visits we had, that's what I remember the most, this young talent that we were just like, wow, these people are incredible. And how would I have discovered that without actually meeting them, at least virtually?
Yeah.
So I think it's really important.
Yeah, and it was actually really interesting, the convening in Asia when we were talking about frontiers of science and how post-pandemic, maybe we need to do more engagement. Shirley, what are your thoughts about how to engage with the youth? I mean, it's just unbelievable. Tell us about your experience with the South Korean convening, how they wanted to pay it forward.
Yes, and that is absolutely wonderful. You think about after the Korean War and the investment that they saw that was made by the U.S. In building the scientific infrastructure within on the peninsula, and the notion of the strength of the science and the technology that came out of South Korea, and now they feel feel compelled to basically spread that beyond to do for others what was done with them. And therefore, to reach out and to engage with young people and with established scientists as well in other nations in the region. And I think that that's absolutely fantastic. But one of the things that I do want to say is that as we begin to look at our scientific infrastructure in the U.S., I think it is important that we embed the idea of a global scientific infrastructure and the need to engage with scientists from all over the world and to begin that early. When you're looking at providing opportunities for graduate students and postdocs to go to conferences and that are international or to participate in virtual conferences that are international and meet others. And I do think that this is absolutely critical in terms of helping to kind of enlarge our vision of what's possible.
Yeah, so, you know, we had this convenience during a pandemic, right? The worst crisis that the world has faced. And so there's a question here about, you know, how can we even talk about collaboration in a crisis where we're all now sort of coming inwards and being nationalistic and only thinking about ourselves? Maybe Ari, you can talk to us about where do we go in history to learn how to behave in a crisis? How can the rest of the world trust America after the way we have behaved during this pandemic?
I think we have some rebuilding to do, but we should never forget that for decades, the United States was generous, generous with aid, generous with educating people. I think, though, in the end, we will need leadership at the top that says, we recognize that we are competing with certain countries, but there are problems that we face, the whole world faces, in which we must work together, and we are prepared to work together with even our adversaries in order to achieve these goals. Remember that we did that with Russia in the midst of the Cold War, and looking and seeing Israel and Iran working together to develop a synchrotron facility in the Middle East, we can do it.
Absolutely. I agree with that. And I will say that I agree with Artie.
Through science and technology over the world. There's a question we have about who should we turn to? Is it UNESCO? Is it the United Nations to be engaged?
There's one area that really needs international help, and that is these endeavors like gravity wave science or black hole science that require major facilities spread around the world. And I think that the U.S. should rejoin UNESCO, and UNESCO should establish a branch that aids in these development of these, what I call dispersed but integrated scientific facilities. And that would be a starting point for further cooperation.
Absolutely. So Peter, do you have any thoughts on how we will get that large scale facility to Africa?
I think, well, you're speaking about the synchrotron facility. I think I think it's important as really a benchmark infrastructure that's needed, that scientists will come. I have no doubt about that. But having a magnet that attracts the best and the brightest from across the continent, supported from the global network of existing synchrotron radiation facilities that already exist. They work together. They often share results and technical innovations. And I think that needs to be worldwide. So there's already an infrastructure there. It just has to take the next step and be engaged in Africa. And I think that's something the United States should champion.
Yeah. So one area of the report that really talked about women in science, and I know that this is near and dear to you, Shirley. So yeah. What did we learn about gender diversity and women in science, and how women all over the world are aspiring to be part of this scientific community? And what can the U.S. do to engage more women in science?
Well, let me just first say that we all still have problems in that regard. We all have to still do better. And I think that we have an opportunity, we have a responsibility as we go forward from the U.S. and engage with our peers that are out there, peer scientists, that we take this notion of openness, diversity, and inclusion with us, and that we support it in other places where we find it. And because in some cases, there is an openness to the talent development. And quite frankly, I don't think that any of us are going to be able to move forward without the talent. You can't just basically bench 50% of the world and then say we have these problems that we need to solve, and yet we aren't utilizing all the talent. And so I do hope, I anticipate that we will carry this imperative along with us as we address the larger workforce development imperative.
Yeah. So now the one question that's come up is, you know, we know all politics are local. And so the question is, given that politicians after this pandemic are going to be thinking about their local issues, what do you think, how do you think the local issues can be integrated into the three reports that we're about to roll out now? Would it have to be one from county to county, or is it really a question of addressing science at national levels or regional levels? Right, because I heard frequently that unless there's political will, so how do we get political will beyond the local issues that the U.S. is facing after this pandemic? So let me start with Artie, and then Peter, and then Shirley.
Okay, Artie.
I should point out that we have a problem nationally that we have to deal with, and that is the concentration of scientific and technological capabilities along the coasts and in Illinois and Michigan, a few states. And we have to deal with that because even in this country, there are specific local questions where local talent has to be applied, just as in Africa, there are local problems with local solutions needed. And so I think one of the problems that we have to resolve in this country is how can we effectively train and provide scientific capabilities around the country. With that will come local support for other scientific ventures and international cooperation.
Absolutely. So, Peter, do you have any thoughts about local issues and then how that spills into international collaboration?
Yeah, I think in terms of local issues, I think number one, it's important to build networks through peer-to-peer collaboration primarily, and listen to what the local issues are. Don't come in with the solution. First, listen, and then start to collaborate and find areas of common interest. And I think part of that, is, which is very important, is also in a number of science fields, and I would say this particularly applies in the biosciences, that developing ethical guidelines and ethical guidelines that are shared values and understood across cultural boundaries is an important discussion to have. And it should be very much at the grassroots level. It shouldn't come from on high. The scientists and the people on the ground doing the work have to have a shared set of understandings about ethical approaches to research. Because difficult questions come up, but one has to be committed to resolving them. And it should not come from on high. It has to be very local.
That's correct. And Shirley, to come back to you, I think we heard over and over again the role that culture, even language, really has in terms of fostering scientific collaboration. We heard about, you know, the U.S. culture is very, very different. And so how do we get to do this international work when even within the United States, we have different cultures across different regions of the U.S., not to talk about across international borders?
I think we have to have more contact. And I think that it's important, as Peter says, we have to listen. And that is, it's absolutely critical that our community also try to draw talent from all of those different cultural bases, because that's really critical in terms of being able to talk to each other and explain what the issues are to each other, to the extent that we may need what is the social scientists would call code switching, and that is to move from our scientific talk into our local vernacular as we engage with communities. I think that we're going to learn a lot right now as we are trying to address this pandemic. You were talking about the local the flyover states and the local settings. The distribution of that vaccine has to be coordinated locally. It is the local health officials, it is the local people who are going to have to make sense out of that on the ground. And then there is the whole question of communities of color who are nervous about even taking the vaccine, given the history of experimentation in some cases on those same communities. So there's going to have to be a language that is developed, an understanding of cultural differences, of cultural experiences, of cultural history that makes some communities more cautious than others. And bringing this about and finding this language to engage is going to be critical. In the same way it's critical in the U.S., it's critical elsewhere to listen and to find ways to communicate that are culturally responsive.
Okay, so now that you've talked about the culture and the language, how about the policing? There was a question here about law enforcement, the Justice Department, some of the really unfortunate experiences that scientists have faced all over the world. Either and also in this country, where scientists have been either persecuted, have been arrested, and they have been labeled as spies. Earlier on, we talked about our engagement with China. These are serious issues that are really affecting international science partnership. So how do we develop trust, and how do we engage with law enforcement that is, at least in the last 4 years, have been really hostile to foreign students and scholars who have come to America to be partners with in American universities? How do we go from there to rebuild trust?
With great difficulty. I do think that because people have had these kinds of encounters, they have been stopped and asked to show all kinds of identification. They have been treated in ways that are not the most welcoming. And I think that what we have to do, and already talked about the fact that we got a lot of repair work to do, and I think we have to own up to the repair work and have those kinds of conversations. Ask people to bear with us until we can get our act together, and then work hard within the community to get our act together.
Okay, so you think we can rebuild trust. Adi, what do you think? You're the science policy guru among us.
Well, you know, Peter and I have discussed this extensively. When you look at investigations of people accused of sending things to China inappropriately, there are some that are quite valid that have led to action. And there are several where the people have ultimately been found innocent or charges have been dropped after considerable damage has been done. It's our sense that we need to build up a mechanism to assist the FBI so that it can determine before it really gets involved in an investigation whether there's meat in it or it's really something quite benign. They could have advisory groups or alternatively build up the scientific expertise within the FBI or both. But we think there needs to be, on the part of the FBI, more technical scientific input before an investigation goes too far. And that would help a great deal in building up trust.
Did you know that there was a national science body within the Department of Justice, an advisory body, that its mandate disappeared in 2018? I hadn't known that.
I think I actually was sort of involved in that in the past, and I think we have to bring it back with strength and effectiveness.
Okay, very good. So a lot of things that we lost, we're going to try to bring back. There's a very interesting question here, and this will go to Peter. Because I think it's actually an important policy question. So what initiatives do you propose to encourage international collaborations? For instance, should international undertakings be included in research proposals evaluation? Because, you know, when you said that most of the high impact papers have international collaborators. So this question is, you know, if you want more international collaborations, should that be an evaluation criteria for research proposals? Could we make that become a policy?
Good question. You put me on the spot. And I would not make that a requirement. But if it adds strength to the scientific objectives of the proposal, then it should be counted as a strength. But it shouldn't be artificial. It shouldn't be, oh, I've got to have an international collaboration. But I would do everything I could to encourage international collaboration. But I think it would be a mistake to just uniformly require it. That, to me, doesn't make sense.
Yeah. But I think he was just saying maybe there would be incentive, because during our convening, we did hear from our international partners that there was not enough funding that they could access. And as a result of that, there was sort of a mismatch in terms of, yes, they have come here, they have trained with us, but then they're back in their country and they have no access to funding or even how to get funding. So how can we create policies that would allow, especially the emerging science partners, to have opportunities to apply for research grants?
I think we need to expand on some of the opportunities that currently exist. They should be enlarged. I think there should be funds available for exploratory contacts to then develop a more extensive proposal for international engagement. But there has to be funding available, particularly to under-resourced partners, that they can be engaged in those discussions. And I think that's an investment the United States should make. And we have in some cases, but I also think we have to build, you know, centers or regions of excellence that can serve a broader community. And that's a very much a regional evaluation that has to be done with potential partners in the global South. I think just spreading money all over the place isn't a solution, but more resources are needed, but think in a very strategic way to seed development of infrastructure. And then, as I say, once the infrastructure is there, it will attract talent. But one has to make sure it's the right infrastructure that's needed
Absolutely. This last question, we'll give it to Archie. And that is, what will it take for the U.S. to rejoin UNESCO and the WHO?
A lot of people writing to their representatives, first of all. And I think the initiative has to come via both Congress and the executive branch. But I also wanted to comment on your last question. And that is, we were very impressed with some agencies of the government that are already involved in international, and they could use more funding. I the Fogarty at NIH, ONR Global, these are agencies that have experience in international funding, in dealing with the global South, and they need our support and OMB's support too.
Okay, very good. So I'm going to throw one last question to all three of you, and we'll start with Shirley. So what can viewers do to support the findings of this report?
I hope that people will, in fact, share it with their networks and ask them to look not only at what we can give, but also what we can get from these enhanced collaborations. And I think that in a lot of cases, people don't understand how much we benefit as a country when we engage with people from other parts of the world in terms of enhancing the science. And I hope that there will be other voices, as Artie said, at the executive level and towards the legislative level, that help people understand how much we have to gain from these kinds of collaborations.
Very good. Artie, what do you have to say?
Well, I think Shirley covered it well, but let me add, one should never forget the power of op-eds in local newspapers. I would hope that some of the people who are listening today would write op-eds for their local papers supporting the ideas presented in the report. And of course, visit their representatives in their local offices with the same message.
Okay, Peter, what would you like those in the audience to do?
Well, I think do whatever Shirley says, number one. and also Artie. But I would add to this, there's always, in the background, always the concern, at least among people in the U.S., I think, that somehow economic competitiveness, we have to keep things to ourselves. And that's in some cases true in the business world. But when we're talking about scientific research and education, it's got to be global now. And for one reason I can give, our national security depends on it. The future of solving problems like, again, climate change and pandemics. If we don't do this globally, we are going to fail.
Yeah, and I'd like to add my own and really to take it back to where how we started. So I'm a physician scientist, and we have talked a lot about fundamental research and how research, science and technology and engineering can seem so far-fetched, but we know that basic science has been so important in solving many human conditions. Talking about the synchrotron, as an oncologist, we're talking about cancer moonshot. We haven't found a cure for cancer, and we don't know where that cure is going to come from. So we want to go all over the world to make sure that we can begin to ask those fundamental questions, because we don't know where the cures will come from. And so whether it's infectious diseases, the next pandemic, whether it's climate change, and of course, the problem of poverty and inequality. There's a lot that science and technology can do, and of course, engineering. As we went all over the world, what I was really excited to see were countries, every country was putting more and more money into their science and technology development. We met with scientists that were working in science parks in Vietnam, in Singapore. And we saw many countries that had previously been very poor rise and bring their people up and eliminate poverty because they invested in science and technology. And of course, we talk about inequality and we talk about how China has been able to raise some of its population from poverty by massive investment in science and technology. So my take home from this report is that we live in a global village. And what happens in one village affects all of us. And so we have to be in it together. And by being in it together, I think we can, as a community of scientists, really be in solidarity. So I know that the WHO started their clinical trial to end this pandemic by doing a solidarity study. And I'm going to turn this over to David by calling all of us scientists, physician scientists, astrophysicists, and biochemists, anyone who has something to give to join us in disseminating this report, because I think the next decade should be really a golden decade for science, technology, and engineering. So thank you for coming, and I'll turn it over to David to give the closing remarks.
Thank you. Thank you, Peter, Artie, Shirley, and Funmi. Thank you for a fantastic exchange and for your tireless work on the Challenges for International Scientific Partnerships initiative. I had the opportunity to take part in the international soundings along with all of you, those sounding meetings virtually done around the world. And to me, the participation by so many exciting young scientists really gave me hope for the future of this country and the world through those types of partnerships that we can establish in the future. A link to this report, America and the International Future of Science, has been placed in the chat, but it can also be found on our website, www.amicad.org. We're looking forward to the next two reports as well. So thank you all for joining us and for your thoughtful questions. Goodbye.